Bit of music from the old movie Predator, a classic, a movie that I've tried ceaselessly to get my esteemed associate to watch, and each time she gets about 20 minutes in, she falls asleep. So I don't understand. I guess there's something hypnotic or trance-like about it. Haven't figured out what that is. Great movie, though, and speaking of movies, rewatched one of my all-time favorites, Aguirre, Wrath of God, directed by Werner Herzog, who's done a number of movies. Big fan of his, but portrays a band of Spanish conquistadors, German film, great stuff, and it's loosely based on a historical figure. When I say loosely, I mean loosely, but the gentleman who plays Aguirre, Klaus Kinski, also in a number of movies, great actor, and in fact, that reminds me, there's a documentary about Klaus Kinski and Werner Herzog, their tumultuous relationship during their career together in films, as they did a number of films together. But the basic premise of the movie is your typical conquistador premise: conquer lands, peoples, discover lost cities of gold. Somehow, somewhere along the way, things get completely screwed up. Aguirre overthrows their leader, declares himself leader, and this his new land that he is conquering. This guy is obviously sycophant and megalomaniacal, to put it lightly. Kind of a metaphor, I guess you could say, for Europe during a certain time in history. But during a particular part in the movie, there's a scene in which someone tries to get over on him, and he puts the kibosh on that right away, stating, "I am the great traitor. There must be no other. Anyone who even thinks about deserting this mission will be cut up into 198 pieces. Those pieces will be stamped on until what is left can be used only to paint walls. Whoever takes one grain of corn or one drop of water more than his ration will be locked up for 155 years. If I, Aguirre, want the birds to drop dead from the trees, then the birds will drop dead from the trees. I am the wrath of God. The earth I pass will see me and tremble." And then probably the most memorable scene in the movie is the end, in which he's stomping around a raft by himself, which has become somehow, I don't remember how, populated with hundreds of monkeys, declaring how great he is and all that he's going to accomplish. And picks up a monkey, holds it up in front of his face, and says, "We will endure." It's a great movie. Anyway, this is Hexes and Soldiers, episode number 33. And if you haven't guessed, my name is Jason. Welcome back for the 33rd time. It is a sunny, wonderful afternoon here in New Orleans, and that reminds me also, Heat of Battle is a wargaming convention that is held here each year, and that's coming up this coming weekend from August 8th through 10th. I have yet to attend because I haven't lived here long enough to attend. I only moved here in January, but I always get frustrated here because it seems like there is no decent war game store, and as well, hardly anybody that even knows what a war game is down here, as opposed to where I lived. But there is this event, and it is held at the World War II Museum, which I have been to and really enjoyed. And there are a couple rules regarding this convention. The games that are played have to relate to or revolve around America in some way, which might sound kind of odd, and well, I guess it is. But anyway, and prior to this year, they only allowed World War II games that related to America's involvement, and I guess they realized if they didn't broaden their horizons that this thing would suffocate and die. So this year, for the first time, they finally decided to allow other games besides World War II war games to be played at this convention, and again, it still has to relate to America's involvement in some way. But they're trying, so I should be at this thing. I only live literally less than 5 minutes away. This thing's being held in my backyard, so I'll be looking for you guys, and I'll recognize all your faces. Maybe we can throw back some beers and play some games. So what else? Main image for this show is by a gentleman named Matt Hall. Found his stuff by a mistake, which is how I usually find things. It's entitled Pride of Our Nation, A Liberation Begins, and I'm quite fond of it. And as well, if you go to Valor Studios, I believe is the name of the place. I don't know if this is the gentleman's official site or not, but you can find the print there, and I think you can purchase it there as well. And they have a picture of it within a frame. Looks very nice with some signatures, etc. And again, I don't know who this guy is. I've never met him. Not getting paid to plug his stuff, but like I said, found it on accident and pretty fond of it. So also, shout outs before I forget. I'd like to say hey to everybody up north. And as I do reside here in the south, I find myself pining again and again for all things northern. And I'll always be a Yankee at heart, but enough of that. So what's new with me? Napoleonic rules. Coming along, I don't know if I'd say nicely, but coming along. I've got maybe half a dozen pages left to type up, and then I have to do some major editing and puzzle piece placing and all kinds of stuff, changes, etc. And as far as the game itself, I've still got some issues to iron out, but nothing too major, and that's just the name of the game. As well, I'm slowly finding myself leaning more and more towards, I guess you call it a break. You know, I've been laying on my Napoleonic couch for a while now, and I think I'm ready to get up and sit in the World War II chair. And then I ordered the expansion game for the Killing Ground, the Overlord D-Day and the Beachhead Battles. I've owned the Killing Ground for a while and would love to attach the D-Day expansion to it and see how that works out. Big D-Day fan, and as well, I went ahead and pre-ordered Day of Days from M&P, and I'll get to that in a second, but in addition to pre-ordering ASL Action Pack number 10, and I'm just a sucker for anything ASL, I'll say it. They could put up ASL toilet paper for pre-order, and I would probably be the first one to pre-order that, if that tells you anything about my dedication to the game. That said, I also have a theoretical shopping cart that is usually full of something, and currently it is. I've got a copy of Deathride Kursk Totenkopf in there, and I've picked this thing up off the shelf and eyeballed it and put it back and picked it up and put it back. Well, it's currently in my cart again, and I don't know what it is. I'm just curious about it, and I think I may end up pulling the trigger on this. But I also have a copy of Last Chance for Victory, the giant Gettysburg game from M&P in the cart as well. And that's been in there for a while. Again, another expensive game, and I guess I'm just reluctant to shell out the cash necessary to acquire these things. But if any of you are familiar with the gentleman known as Callendale, he's got some videos he started posting about Last Chance for Victory, so if any of you are curious as well, you can follow along with his video play and review of the game. As far as reading goes, I've got books all over the place. Been reading Matthew Cooper's The German Army, 1933-45. You're going to need a glass of water when you read this because it's very dry reading. You're not going to find any edge-of-your-seat, nail-biting stories or accounts. It is strictly informational, lots of information, in fact. And basically, for anybody interested in the German army, this is pretty much the book on the subject. I don't know of anything else I would recommend. So check that out. That's Matthew Cooper's The German Army. Of course, still a couple of Napoleonic books that I've been fingering through, and got the old Russia Against Napoleon by Dominic Levine. Probably my favorite Napoleonic book of all time. And then I got some little dinky Napoleonic 1812 Moscow book that I checked out from the library. But that's the reading, and As far as news goes, thought I'd do something slightly different. Rather than, and I should say, GMT does their monthly updates, and I usually pretty much just reiterate what they say. But and then that goes the same for M&P and basically any other company. If they have something new to reveal, I repeat that. But I thought this week I'd do it a bit different, and again, rather than just sound like a broken record, go to the pre-orders. And I was only able to do this with GMT and MMP because these are apparently the only two companies that reveal the current status of pre-order numbers when it comes to a game. And what I did was take the top 10, or should I say top 11, pre-orders by way of number and arranged them so that might be a decent indicator of what the pulse of the wargaming community is beating against. So we'll start as well differently than I usually do and work our way from the top down. So we'll start with Fire in the Lake, and this thing has this is the Vietnam game. It has 2,081 orders, and this is as of yesterday, Friday. Won by the Sword. This is a two-player game of operational warfare in the 17th century. Armies maneuver on a point-to-point map of southern Germany, based on the road network available at the time. And each game is centered around a major battle or full campaign season. This is by designer Ben Hall, and this is up to 1,216 orders. Number three, Cactus Air Force, has 1,212 orders. This is a solitaire game on the air battle over Guadalcanal. And for all you fans of the air battle over Guadalcanal, you can now feel vindicated. Commands and Colors, Napoleonics, The Prussian Expansion, something that I have not pre-ordered but will be purchasing, as I have all of the others in the series except the Spanish expansion. This is up to 1,099 pre-orders, which brings us to Silent Victory, which is the next game in Consum Press's sub-warfare series, the first one being The Hunters, which, great game. I enjoyed it. Haven't played a ton of sub-games, but if I had to play again, this would be the game I play, The Hunters. So, Silent Victory. And then we have Fields of Fire Volume 2 with the Old Breed. Rounds out the first Field of Fire game. This has 830 orders. And Mark Simic's strategic Civil War game has 806 orders. What else? ASL Action Pack 10, which I already mentioned I had pre-ordered, is up to 776 orders, which ironically is tied with Mark Herman's Churchill game. Also has 776 orders, and that's quite a testament to ASL, a little dinky action pack. Just a few scenarios, and I don't know, was it one map or maybe two? And pair that up to a complete game by veteran designer Mark Herman, and they're neck and neck, so that's quite a testament to ASL and the fan base. Battle for Sicily, 765 orders currently for that game. Operation Dauntless would be next with 750 orders, and that is followed by Day of Days, another game. Which I finally pre-ordered. And I don't typically pre-order things. In fact, I don't know that I've ever pre-ordered a game, and I don't know why that is. No reason for it, and I'm not proud of it, but I plan to amend that. Well, I have, as I've pre-ordered these two things. But Day of Days, the standard combat series game from MMP, again, 717 orders, and I am proudly the 717th person to order that thing. So that's the pre-orders and the rankings of the pre-orders, something I haven't done yet. But that brings us to the Situation Room. And this week in the Situation Room, we will be focusing primarily on airborne slash paratroop actions behind enemy lines just before, during, and just after the D-Day beachhead landings. These things were of vital importance, and really, the whole success, in my opinion, of D-Day hinged on the success of these airborne operations that took place. So we'll start with 101st Airborne, which probably most famously known for Easy Company and Band of Brothers, as well as 82nd Airborne. and also some British paratrooper and glider troops. But you've got Major Dick Winters from 101st, goes on to great fame and renown with his action behind the lines. But let me start with saying, why bother at all with this stuff? And this is probably self-explanatory to many of you, but I'm sure there's probably a few out there that are thinking, okay, just bomb the crap out of everything with bombers and move the men up the beach and just head right in. What? Why even bother with this pre-dawn paratrooper business? Well, you need to do this because you need to capture certain strong points, but probably just as important, if not more so, you're going to need to capture certain beach exits and secure them. And I'm talking about bridges, among other things, and you can't just go and bomb the crap out of something because you're either going to blow the bridge or just kill a couple of Germans and the bridge would remain in German hands. So anyway, you got to drop paratroopers over these areas to secure these things and hold them. So you're looking at June 6th, 1 a.m., 23,400 paratroopers begin appearing in the sky and fall slowly towards the ground below. Soon anti-aircraft fire erupts, lighting the entire sky, and as planes start to get hit, many pilots panic because they haven't experienced flying through anti-aircraft fire before. So they begin flying a bit too fast and a bit too low for any real accurate drop. As a result, men become separated from their equipment and are just basically scattered everywhere. Case in point was a famous depiction within the movie Longest Day, where a guy gets dropped and he ends up hanging off a spire of a church. This is an actual historical thing that happened. This happened to a gentleman who, his name was John Steele. He was a private and was the American paratrooper who landed on the church tower in San Maraglise, which is the first village in Normandy to be liberated by Americans. And, of course, made famous, as I said, in the movie The Longest Day. So this would consist of American soldiers of the 82nd Airborne that parachuted into the area west of San Maraglise in waves. The town had been the target of an aerial attack, and a stray incendiary bomb had set fire to a house east of the town square. The church bell was rung to alert the town of the emergency, and townspeople turned out in large numbers to form a bucket brigade supervised by members of the German garrison. And by 0100 hours, the town square was well lit and filled with German soldiers and villagers when two sticks, or plane loads of paratroopers from the 1st and 2nd battalions, were dropped in error directly over the village. So the paratroopers were easy targets, and Steele was one of only a few non-casualties. He actually survived this. His parachute was caught in one of the pinnacles of the church tower, causing the cables on his parachute to stretch to their full length, leaving him hanging on the side of the church to witness the carnage. And the wounded paratrooper hung there limply for about 2 hours, pretending to be dead, before the Germans took him prisoner. And he later escaped from the Germans and rejoined his division when U.S. troops of the 3rd Battalion, 505th Parachute Infantry Regiment attacked the village, capturing 30 Germans and killing another 11. And for these actions and his wounds, he was awarded the Bronze Star for valor and the Purple Heart for being wounded in combat. And to this day, these events are commemorated by the Airborne Forces Museum in the center of San Maraglise and in the village church, where a parachute with an effigy of a private Steele and his airborne uniform hangs from the steeple. And there's a picture of this if you go online and look it up. But there is, in fact, just a dummy paratrooper hanging from a full parachute that is attached to one of the spires. And it's quite odd to see. But yeah, you can actually look at this. And bullet holes are still visible in the church's stone walls as well. Inside, there are stained glass windows with one depicting the Virgin Mary with paratroopers falling in the foreground. And there's a picture of that as well. Some pretty interesting stuff. So that is one small event that's taking place during all this chaos. So you have Major Dick Winters landing with nothing but a map and a knife as his equipment has been lost. And here's where your crickets come in, your little clickers. Again, if you've seen the movie The Longest Day or read anything about this, one of the ways that the paratroopers communicated with each other was to use this little clicker, metal clicker thing that sounded like mechanical cricket. Which was to be answered by another paratrooper who had the same thing. So Winters uses his clicker after he lands to meet up with some other paratroopers, and he learns he's landed near San Miraglis, which is inland from Utah Beach, but more importantly, he's 5 miles away from his objective of Saint-Mère-du-Mont. So he's got a bit of a trek to make before it's all said and done. So 2:15 a.m. back at Caen, von Hueck and the 21st Panzer Division desperately desire to push forward, but basically have to stay put and wait for Hitler's approval. And this is happening all over the place. Hitler is in charge of the tank divisions, and they got to wait for him, you know. 2:30 in the morning, what's Hitler doing? Well, he's asleep, and nobody wants to wake him up and be the bearer of bad news. So, as I said, Hitler's got sole control over the tank divisions, so they can really do nothing but run their engines, smoke cigarettes, and cuss. Rommel, too, who was put in charge of the defenses in Normandy, is busy out of town, as it was his wife's birthday, of all things. So he's nowhere around to take the reins. So you've got the paratroopers scattered everywhere. They're behind schedule. And that brings us to another famous encounter known as Brearcourt Manor. And that also brings us back to Major Dick Winters. And he's told that there's fire all along that hedgerow there. Take care of it. That is his introduction to what becomes known as Brearcourt Manor. He gets no briefing and finds himself given the task of destroying a German artillery battery. This is consists of 4 guns that were initially reported to be 88mm guns firing onto Causeway Exit Number 2 leading off Utah Beach and disrupting landing forces that are trying to advance inland. And a head-on attack has already failed. So, again, Winters is told to take care of the fire from the right flank. And he undertook a reconnaissance about 8:30, after which he collected a team of 12 men from his own and other companies beyond knowledge of the general location of the gun emplacement south of Le Grand Chemin, and without information of the other side of the hedgerow, his team attacked Brearcourt Manor, located 3 miles southwest of Utah Beach and north of the village of Saint-Marie-du-Mont. And there he discovered number 6 battery of the 90th Artillery Regiment, consisting not of 88mm guns, but 405mm howitzers. And these things are connected by some nasty trenches and defended by a full company of soldiers. So Winters held that the unit was part of the 6th Fallschirmjäger Regiment, with emplaced MG-42 machine gun nests covering the gun emplacements, and the 1st Battalion of the 6th had been ordered to Saint-Marie-du-Mont from Carentan during the afternoon, but arrived after dark. And the 1st Company 919th Grenadier Regiment was posted at Saint-Marie-du-Mont and was responsible for the area. So the U.S. paratroopers were opposed by approximately 60 German soldiers. And remember, this is 12 guys, actually 13 including Winters. So the crew originally assigned to the 405mm guns had apparently deserted during the night of the airborne landings. Oberst-Lieutenant Friedrich von der Heydt of the German 6th Parachute Regiment, upon discovering they had been abandoned while observing the landings at Utah Beach, actually traveled to Carentan, where he ordered his 1st Battalion to occupy and hold Saint-Marie-du-Mont and Brearcourt and find men to work on the artillery battery. So when he comes to this Brearcourt Manor, Winters comes up with his plan. He positioned a pair of machine guns for covering fire and sent several soldiers to one flank to destroy a machine gun nest with grenades and provide covering fire. And while the trenches connecting the artillery positions provided the Germans with a fairly easy way to supply and reinforce the guns, they also proved to be their biggest weakness, because after destroying the 1st gun position, Winters and the rest of his squad used the trenches as cover to approach and continue to attack the remaining guns one by one, and each gun was destroyed by placing a block of TNT down its barrel and using a German potato smasher to set the charges off. So reinforcements from Company D arrived to complete the assault on the 4th and last gun, and this assault is led by a gentleman known as Ronald Spears, a 2nd Lieutenant, and he had a reputation as an excellent and extremely aggressive officer, as he led his men against the last gun position by running outside of the trenches and exposing himself to enemy fire. So after the 4 guns were disabled, Winter's team came under heavy machine gun fire from Brearcourt Manor, and he had to withdraw. During the withdrawal, he somehow stumbles on a cache of German maps. And what these turn out to be are maps that reveal each defensive position for Utah Beach. Everything. It's all listed here. And when he realizes what he has, he makes it a point to return it to get it straight to battalion so they can adjust accordingly. And when this happens, First Lieutenant Nixon, realizing this to be an essential piece of intelligence, runs 3 miles to Utah Beach and passes the information up the chain of command. And command was apparently so thrilled with the information that Nixon and Winters had sent that it sent the first two ranks to reach Utah Beach to support the paratroopers. And this consisted of, among other things, tanks. So Winters directs the fire of two American tanks, which arrive as promised, in order to clear out the machine gun nests that are in and around Brercourt Manor. And apparently these tankers hadn't seen any action yet, and once they started firing, were reluctant to stop firing, and Winters comments on this, saying he didn't think they'd ever stop. But anyway, that is an account of Brercourt Manor, and then that would bring us to about 12 noon. The 101st Airborne has pretty much cleared a path for the Allies to move inland, so things are looking up for the troops moving in off the beaches, and a lot of this, if not all of it, is due to 82nd Airborne, 101st, as well as the British holding Pegasus Bridge, among other things. So, although it got off to a hairy start, the goings-ons behind the lines prior to the first American boot hitting the beach was pretty much a success. But among other things that are going on at this time is an area that is probably most famous, and that would be Carentan. And you might be familiar with the Battle of Carentan, thanks to, of course, Band of Brothers. They have a depiction of that. Quite a heavy battle takes place. And I have to ask, what is it with pianos and war movies? Is this a thing that is based on historical fact? People are consulted about how to depict a battle scene. Is there a guy that goes, okay, you got to have a piano drug out in the middle of the crossroads in the middle of a town? Because these things pop up all the time, and I'm just curious. What is the deal with the piano? Is it that somebody wanted to steal the piano and only got that far? Was it somebody that has always wanted to play the piano outside and got his wish? What is the deal with the piano in the middle of a town during a depiction of a World War II battle? I don't understand. Anyway, that's neither here nor there. Winters and his soldiers did see some rough combat at Carentan, in fact, but it was nothing really in comparison to what the 501st and 502nd saw. But first, what's so important about Carentan? Carentan is a town of about 4,000 people, and it lay astride the main road running to Cherbourg at the tip of the Cotentin Peninsula. The Germans, of course, wanted to keep the town as the Allies needed it to bridge incoming troops from Omaha Beach and Utah Beach north and south. And if you have seen the series Band of Brothers, you would know of Carentan because they depict this battle in, I think, the third episode. So on June 12th, on the edge of Carentan, the 506th 2nd Battalion, of which the 2nd Platoon was part, is walking down a road readying for their all-important attack at dawn. When all hell broke loose, one or two German troopers came out in the middle of the intersection, pouring machine gun fire up and down the road. Mortar fire soon joined the barrage, as did tanks. And the Germans virtually stripped the hedgerow, as it was all the airborne troops could do to stay out of the way of the bullets. The enemy fire split the platoon, and the Germans were in a perfect position to wipe out not only the platoon, but the entire company. So they quickly scrambled to the ditches along the road next to hedgerows. And so panicked were they that some of them even tried digging foxholes with their fingers. And this would easily prove to be some of the heaviest fire that the 506th would experience. But actually, in comparison to the 501st and the 502nd, the 506th, no pun intended, had it easy. The 506th was held in reserve while the other two battalions charged German positions, in a two-pronged attack. And it is during this time that you also have Cole's charge, which involved this gentleman who took 250 men down a road in a bayonet charge to clear out stubborn German forces. And the charge led the Americans over a river causeway past hedgerows manned by German paratroopers and through a stone-walled path that ended at a small farmhouse. The breakthrough forced the Germans to pull back half of their defenses, but it came at an enormous cost, because at the end of the charge, only 132 American men remained, and the action would subsequently be remembered as Purple Heart Lane. And the show Band of Brothers did depict Easy Company's own participation in a similar charge on the other side of Carentan that visually mimicked what the attack at Purple Heart Lane must have looked like. But meanwhile, the main German unit charged with holding Carentan was, of course, the elite 6th Fallschirmjager Regiment, and this was a crack group of Germans, not your grandma's old-school Germans, but these guys are mean bastards, and these guys put up a hell of a fight, and as a result, the battle for Carentan represented some of the fiercest combat in Normandy, and this can most likely be chalked up not just to the strategic location of the town, but the fact that you have two elite fighting forces going at it, as well as the excellent defensive positions and overall unit cohesion on the German side, coupled with the high morale of the American paratroopers. So overall, for the most part, this was an infantry-on-infantry battle that often led to hand-to-hand combat. And the fighting was so brutal that historians studying both sides of the battle agree. It was one of the few instances where both Americans and Germans engaged in no quarter. That is to say, neither side was willing to take prisoners. So here at Carentan, some of the fiercest fighting of Normandy would take place, and all for 6 square miles of French soil. So I'll conclude there, and of course I'm leaving out a ton of stuff. Can't include everything for time purposes, but all this and more is faithfully depicted in games, and probably the most intriguing game that isn't even out yet. I don't know if it will come out. Conflict of Heroes support for that seems to have dropped off the edge of the earth. The solo expansion was supposed to come out years ago. That hasn't come out yet. We've got Guadalcanal expansion that is slated to come out next. And for purposes of this show, it would be the expansion after Guadalcanal, known as First Men In, that would interest us. If and when that will come out, who knows. Number of scenarios listed on the site, though, and they all look good. Everything from San Marigliese to Brercourt Manor. As I said, if and when this thing comes out, who knows, in development. Even the Academy Games site, I don't know that anything has been updated forever. No offense to Uwe Eichert. He's done some great work, but honestly, maybe he has too many irons in the fire. Turn back to the Conflict of Heroes series, please. We're begging you. Other than that, you have for you Combat Commander fans, and I know there's at least one out there, Paratrooper module. And this would be the first module for Combat Commander. Again, number of scenarios dealing with just what I have been talking about. So there's that route for you Combat Commander fans. Obviously, there is some ASL stuff that deals with just this topic. And among the myriad scenarios out there, there are a ton that deal with this topic. But specifically, you have a module, and this would be Module 2 for ASL. Out of print now, of course. Came out way back a when in 1986. This is also a introductory module to help people learn the ASL system. And this would include 8 scenarios, among them dealing with Saint-Marie-Glise, Folkerville, Saint-Com, Dumont, La Fierre, Neuville-au-Plain, and Pointe-l'Abbe. But also from a miniatures angle, Flames of War has dealt with this stuff in a fair manner. And I haven't talked much at all since this show began about miniatures, and I plan to do that show at some point, a strictly miniature show. That's coming. It's right around the corner. But you know, I played Flames of War heavily at one point. Obviously, I don't much anymore, and I sold some stuff. But one of the things that I did keep was the D-1 Intelligence Handbook, and this thing includes histories of the British 6th and the U.S. 82nd and 101st Airborne Divisions, and covers their preparations and forces used in Normandy, the role in D-Day, and subsequent operations, and also has complete organizations for British parachute and air landing companies, as well as U.S. parachute rifle and glider rifle companies. It includes all combat weapons support and divisional support options. No additional handbook is required to field any of these airborne forces. So for all you fans of Flames of War that wish to engage in airborne operations, you guys have not been excluded either. But perhaps a more obvious selection would be the Band of Brothers Screaming Eagles game. Came out in 2011 from Worthington Games by designer Jim Crone. This is a fast-playing game of squad-level combat in World War II. Covers the exploits of the 101st and their battles from D-Day through the Bulge. And the rules are very simple. There's no combat charts at all, and with very few exceptions to remember. Yet the game is meant to be all-encompassing, apparently based on years of research. The system uses a unique suppression mechanic, and there are no longer two unique states for a unit, but varying degrees of suppression. And this allows suppression to accumulate from multiple fire sources, which means that the unit will not take a morale check until it is asked to do something. So you never know for sure how your units are going to respond until they're needed. And although casualties can be caused by artillery and heavy weapons, which makes them prime battlefield targets, squads will never cause significant casualties shooting at range at dug-in first-line troops, and their goal is to fire and maneuver. Sections of the enemy force must be pinned down and eliminated from up close. The system itself forces this realistic play, and in a similar fashion, the system rewards you for spreading your troops out and other realistic concepts. Another unique feature of the game is its use of proficiency and casualty ratings to differentiate squads in areas besides just morale. So this is the first game in the series, which includes Band of Brothers Ghost Panzer, and this is a standalone game that is set on the Eastern Front and follows the 11th Panzer Ghost Division. And I think I read somewhere at one time that this game, as well as, if I remember correctly, Lock and Load Band of Heroes, which I'll get to in a second, is a worthy competitor for ASL, if not better, in the respect that it is more realistic. You know, this argument will never end. And if you remember that these are only games, you're never going to ever reach that level of realism that seemingly some players look for. So just bear that in mind. Another obvious entry here would be Lock and Load's Band of Heroes. Came out 2005. Designed by Mark Walker, busy man indeed. It's a tactical board game, Tour de Force, that covers the battles of America's airborne troops during June of 44. The second complete module in his Lock and Load Forgotten Heroes Vietnam game system. This includes a bucket full of new weapons, squads, and vehicles, including U.S. Airborne, German SS, and Fallschirmjäger troops, as well as Tiger, Sherman, Stuart, and Panzer III tanks. You got your MG42s, MG34s, and among tons of other stuff. But the 16 scenarios that are included are really the selling point, and they tell the story of the men from the 101st and 82nd Airborne Divisions fighting the Germans in the Normandy hedgerows during this time. So it comes with six mounted maps, 480 counters, 16 skill cards providing leaders and heroes with special abilities, and your 16 scenarios. And as such, I think I'll stop here. Now, there are a ton of games that deal with the airborne element as a, I guess you would call it, sideshow to the bigger event. Too many to recount here, but there are also those to consider. But overall, I think that does it for this show, and as far as future shows go, I think there's going to be an indefinite lull or pause until the next one. Number of things going on that require my attention here in real world land. But one last thing, I would like to give a hearty thank you to everybody who has listened to these things and complimented me and given me suggestions along the way. It is greatly appreciated, and honestly, if I have made it this far, it's because of you guys. So with that said, as usual, thanks for listening, and keep gaming.